Good morning.
Good morning.
You know what that is? Turn that down some. You okay? That static that you're hearing is coming from where that cord goes into the mic itself.
Okay.
I'm saying that's where that static's coming from.
That's a weak point.
Well, good morning. It's good to be here. It's been a while since I've been able to preach before you guys. I appreciate this opportunity. I'd like to continue on in 1 Peter. And as Myron read to us, we looked at 1 Peter verses 17 through 20. And let's look at that again. Verse 17. And if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your stay here in what? What does the King James say?
Yeah.
Does anybody else have another version that says something different than fear? Everybody has King James versions here? Really? New King James says the same thing in fear. I don't know, I don't have that either. Okay. When you see this text and it says to pass the time of your search, yeah, that word in fear, what does that bring to your mind, that word fear? Does it mean that you should be constantly afraid, that you can't do nothing because of fear?
Reverence.
There you go. That's what I want you to see. I'm going to turn this thing off because it's going to make a lot of noise.
Well, so no, we don't have that problem in Sabbath school. I don't know what. Move it up here.
I'm trying to get another one going right now.
Okay.
You want to hold the handheld?
Yes.
It's over by the piano.
This one?
No, the piano.
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 I know what piano is. You know how fast your mind can think? You guys are saying piano, and I'm standing up at that going, why do you keep telling me piano? Here. Because I keep hearing prayer. Okay, how's that?
Great.
All right. So what I want you to see is when I first joined the church and I first started reading the Bible, and I came across a text like this where it spoke of fear, I did not know what that word meant except for what we normally think about the word fear, to be afraid. And if any of you have ever been really afraid, it's really hard to actually think straight, to actually do anything. There are some people who, when they are afraid, they just shut right down. They can't do anything. That's not what this word means. Okay? That word fear is a healthy respect for who God is. Okay? Reverence would be another word. Who are you to fear? Are you to fear man and man's governments? Who does the Bible say you should fear? God. Okay? And that word fear is again to respect who He is. Why is God able to put conditions and restrictions on your life and how you live? Does He have the right to do that?
Yeah.
Do you understand what I mean by restrictions and conditions? Aren't the Ten Commandments conditions and restrictions?
Yes.
Thou shalt not is a restriction. Is that right? It's also a condition. Why is God able to do that? Does He have the right?
Yes.
Now, aren't you free moral agents?
Yes.
So, why does God have the right to put restrictions on you? Or conditions? Now, see, I know you guys are thinking of those two words in the negative. But are the Ten Commandments negative?
No.
And that's what you need to think about restrictions and conditions. When they come from God, they're not negative. I'm thankful that God said, thou shalt not kill, and thou shalt not lie or bear false witness, thou shalt not steal. Right? That's not negative when it comes to interpersonal relationships. That's a positive thing. Right? So that restriction is not a restriction at all. This is why James calls the Ten Commandments the law of what?
Liberty.
What does that word liberty mean?
Freedom.
Freedom. Right? So God's law is not restrictive. It's actually what true freedom really is. What would be your ideal of heaven on earth? Would it be that you would have all the money that you could want? That you could have all the possessions that this world affords to build and make and give? Or would it be that you could walk down the street without ever having to worry about violence happening to you or your family? Would it be that you could live in your house in peace and never have to worry about somebody breaking in at nighttime?
Yeah.
Or stealing your stuff? Or, like I said, any of those negative things that people view the Ten Commandments as being. Now, you realize that the world doesn't have a problem so much with the last five, because the last five are dealing with how we interact with each other. You realize that almost every government in the world, if they have laws, are based on those five. So the real problem comes with the first four. Why is that? Because they deal with God. And not just God in the plural, but God, the one and only true God. And those first four let you know that there is only one God, and that there is only one creator of this world and everything that you see that God created. And so these first four, these commandments, the world has problems with because, number one, we could have laws and yet know God that actually brought about those laws in the first place? What is the difference between a moralist and a Christian? The world's full of moralists. Almost every actor and celebrity that you see can be defined as a moralist, because they will come to some cause and bring their celebrity to that cause to help raise awareness or money or whatever. Right? So what's the difference between them and a follower of Jesus Christ?
God.
And then God requires something from his followers. Right? That God requires you to live a life that shows that there is a true God, right? Hence, pass the time of your sojourning here in fear. Respect, showing the community around you that there is a God and he can be seen through your life. What is one of the greatest causes of atheism in our world?
Christians.
Say it loud, because you're right. That's what I was going to say.
Christians.
How many of you guys believe in that? I wouldn't say Christians. I would say false Christians. Or as the spirit of prophecy says, nominal Christians.
Carnal.
Carnal Christians. Do you believe that there are churches that teach you can be saved as a carnal Christian?
They don't know.
You just lose. You just lose your reward. Okay, so instead of a big mansion, you get a tiny mansion. Right? So I want you to understand when you see this, again, what this word here means. You realize that the Bible speaks over and over again about cowardice and it doesn't speak about being a coward in a positive light. God has no respect for cowards. You guys understand that, right? So when you see this word fear, you need to have a clear understanding of what it means. So, for as much as you know that you are not redeemed with corruptible things, such as silver and gold, what does Paul mean by not being redeemed by corruptible things? Material things. Well, what he was talking about is idols. Right? If you had an idol and you had the money for a good idol, it would be made out of what? Wood? Or silver or gold? Right? Now, the world today... It's just something about me. The world today looks at that and says, we don't worship idols here in this country anymore. Is that true?
No.
Ray, what is some modern idols that we worship?
Sunday worship.
Say it.
Sunday worship.
Okay, that's not what I was thinking, but that is...
Money.
That is, okay. Money?
Position.
Position, power, material things, right? I had a friend of mine who took better care of his car than he did his family. And he loved his car more than his wife. That's an idol. But an idol is anything that you spend more time with than with God. Mm-hmm. Can television be an idol?
Yes.
Entertainment?
Yes.
Internet?
Internet, all that. So we have, instead of having idols of silver and gold of images, Satan now has hundreds of different idols for us to bow down to today. Okay? But understand that we were not redeemed with these corruptible things or from your vain conversations received by traditions of your fathers. Have you ever read that and said, what does he mean by that? Most of the time, we just kind of blow over that and not even try to think what he's talking about. Have any idea what that means? What are these corruptible things that are vain conversations received by traditions of your fathers?
Behavior.
Now, you need to understand, Paul's dead. Paul was dealing with Gentiles and also Jews. And when he dealt with both of them, if there was a large Jewish congregation that became Christians, he was also dealing with Jews of the circumcision. Right? And they knew their pedigrees. It's another word for pedigree that the Bible uses.
Genealogy.
Genealogies, right? And Paul, in another place in Scripture, talks about not getting into arguments about genealogies. Okay? Because to them, how they could trace back their lines all the way back to Abraham is how they were saved. It was their guarantee. Okay? That was like their version of once saved, always saved.
And we all go back to one.
Even past Abraham, right?
Yeah.
So listen. Does that have anything, now that had everything to do with the people Paul was writing this to, but 2,000 years later, does that have anything to do with us? Yes. Vain conversations from the traditions of your father?
Oh, yeah.
This has something to do with what Ray brought up when I asked him about idols. False religious teachings. Why do you go to the church that you go to? Do you go there because that's the church your father went to? Or your father's father went to? Do you hold your faith because that's the tradition of your family? Or do you hold it because that's what you have seen through the indwelling of the Holy Spirit and through the study of God's Word to be the truth?
Amen.
I have met some third, fourth generation Adventists who the only reason why they're Adventists is because they're third and fourth generation. And they're very proud of that, just like the Jews were proud of their genealogies. And that's their ticket of being saved. I'm a fourth generation Adventist. Means absolutely nothing, right? What is it that saves you? Or better question, who is it that saves you?
Jesus.
Right. And it is only a relationship with Jesus Christ that is going to be your ticket to heaven.
Amen.
Right? So you weren't saved by corruptible things like silver and gold. You weren't saved by vain things such as the tradition of your fathers. But you were saved with the precious blood of Christ. Why is the blood of Christ so precious? Have you ever thought about that? Okay, these are some good answers. Hold that. What did you say? The blood, His blood was spilt for you. That makes it precious, right? Makes it precious to us as individuals. What did you say, Jenna?
Blood represents the life of Christ.
Blood represents the life of Christ, and that life was lived and given for you. So, hold on, let me take this side here.
Clean.
Which is what this means, that it was as a lamb without blemish, without spot. It was pure. It was clean. Yes?
It was the blood of God Himself.
It was the blood of God Himself. I like that, right?
Perfect atonement.
Perfect atonement. What does that word atonement mean?
At one.
Being at one with God. Without the shedding of blood, there's no remission
of sin. So, Ricky, what did you have?
That was it.
Atonement, theological word, a really deep word that every Christian should understand the meaning of, because that's what this is all about. Why do you need to be at one with God?
Because sin has separated us.
You understand that? Sin has separated you. Now, did that sin happen after you became a certain age? Happened from when you were conceived. David says, I was conceived in what?
Sin.
In sin. I was conceived in iniquity. Right? So, at conception, you are doomed. You understand that?
Amen.
Doomed. But because of this lamb, because of the precious blood of Christ, who was a lamb without blemish and without spot, He was able to reconcile you back to God.
Amen.
Do you reconcile yourself to God?
No.
If you could do that, that would be a salvation by works, right? Is there anything you can do that will allow you to say to God, I deserve to be here?
No.
So, this is the difference between Christianity and every other religion on the face of the earth. Now, we say that over and over again. I can remember saying that at least 12 times. Okay? But you live in America where you're free to come to church. Okay? And most people you meet either know something about Christianity. Most people may even say they believe in Jesus and accept Him as their Savior. Okay? But a lot of people have no idea what it means to be a true follower of Jesus Christ. If I say that I believe that Jesus died for my sins, does that make me a Christian? What are you studying in your Sabbath school class? Who taught today? You or you did? What are you studying in your Sabbath school class? This is a new quarter. What are you studying?
Well, we did. We started on the book of James.
Okay. The book of James. Now, the first lesson, it's either the first or second, somewhere in there, you're going to get to this point where the writer has to bring up the difference between what James writes and what Paul writes. Right? Because a lot of people that take the Bible and say, I don't believe it, it's full of contradictions, will take those two books and say, see what he says? See what his says? Do you realize that the Catholic Church used the book of James in their defense of their theology against Martin Luther and his defense of his theology? You realize that Martin Luther didn't think that the book of James should be included in the book of the canon of Scripture? But listen, was James correct?
Yes.
Was Paul correct?
Yes.
How are you saved? By your works or by your faith?
By your faith.
Now, don't you like how both of these guys revert back to Abraham to make their point? But they come at it from two different angles.
So the opposite side of the same coin.
opposite side of the same coin. Now listen. What did the party of the circumcision always accuse Paul of? Why were they able to start riots wherever he went? What did they accuse Paul of? They accused him of teaching the people to throw away the law of Moses.
Yes.
That they did not have to follow it. Is that what Paul was teaching?
No.
Paul said, should we sin more so that grace may abound? Absolutely not. God forbid. But yet, when Paul gave his teachings on grace, you had those who did not fully convert and give their hearts to Christ take his teachings and twist them. And said, we don't have to do anything except believe. That is a teaching that has never left this earth because it is alive and well today. Right?
Amen.
And so, James, dealing with this situation, made it very clear by saying, show me your works to prove to me your faith. Right? James wasn't saying you are saved by works. James was saying that if you are truly Christ, then the works better be there, and I better be able to see them. Because Jesus himself said the same thing. If you love me, right? And we are not to judge, he said, right? But how do you know the true believer from the false believer? By their fruits. What are the fruits? That's their works. Okay? The difference between that theology and Catholicism is Catholicism says to be saved, you have to have these works. And when they say that you have to have these works, what they're meaning is you have to have the Mass, you have to have the communion. There's a special word that the church has for that, and it just slipped my mind. No, I mean for all of these, the sacraments.
Okay.
The sacraments are part of your salvation. And if you do not have them in Catholic theology, you are not saved. Hence, their idea of salvation by faith and works.
And under 18, under your traditions.
Okay. So, when James says, show me your faith by your works, what's the difference between what he's saying and the theology of Catholicism? Oh, God. Why is there, huh?
Well, your works only shows what's already in your heart.
Very good. Yes, ma'am.
Sometimes you think it earns you merit.
There's
your works you think is merit.
There's the dividing line. The dividing line is if I am saved by works, and the works are by the church, then whatever the church tells me has got to be correct. Is everything I say to you right? Thank God that you know that. The answer to that is no. When you listen to me, what do you